Where our focus is on loving God and loving one another. God is crazy in love with you and you and you and you. I extend the firepower of God to us, to you today. Please rise as you are able in body or spirit and join me in the call to worship. We await God's instructions for our lives.
We eagerly look forward to learning more about ways to serve God.
The time is coming when our service will be needed here.
Let God's love flood through our service to others.
Wait. Listen. The time is near.
Open our hearts and spirits, O Lord, to hear your word for us today. Thank you all for connecting with us today, and may the peace of Christ be with you all.
And with you all.
MCCQC continues to be the church, no matter what happens in the world. Praise God. If you are attending in person, please fill out the participation card that you'll find in the chair in front of you, or ask an usher for a card, and place it in the offering plate as it is passed later in the service. Online, let us know you're participating through the comment section. It is important that we have your email. This will assure us that you are kept up to date on things that are going on, and also allow us to share our weekly prayers, events, and inspirational email with you. And for other announcements, I don't think I have any.
I do.
Oh,
wow. I know.
There are good things coming. We have Pride Month coming up very quickly, and we need your help. If you're able to be one of our walkers in the parade or help with the tables, let me know. And also, I want to make a pitch for our food pantry. The need is great. It gets wiped out like almost immediately. So if you can help, we need groceries. Durable goods for the food pantry. Thank you.
Thank you for supporting this faith community. Your giving matters as we tear down walls and build up love. Thank you for whatever you can do. During the time of giving, please join us in singing our song of preparation for prayer. Ushers, please come forward at this time. Rekindle in us the fire of your spirit to lead, guide, and direct us in difficult times. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Melt us, mold us, fill us, use us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Whisper in our ears again this morning that we are miracles, not mistakes. Teach us to love ourselves as deeply as you love us. God, who never leaves us alone, thank you for connections, relationships. Teach us to connect more deeply with one another. Holy One, bless all those on our prayer list with your healing light and the warmth of your spirit. And now, with just a brief name or a phrase, what else shall we pray?
Jamie.
Ron.
Jerry,
Captain.
And Rob's asking for prayers for her grandchildren.
Friends struggling with cancer.
The nation.
Thank you, wonderful listener, mover, and shaker. God, for being with us always. Amen.
Our God is an awesome God who reigns from
Hear this reading of Acts chapter 1, verses 6 to 14. The disciples asked the resurrected Jesus, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" Jesus replied, "It is not for you to know the times or period that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, Jesus was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two beings in white robes stood by them. They said, "O you Galileans, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem, and they were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as Jesus' brothers.
Please rise, whether in body or spirit, as you are able. Hear this good news reading from Luke, chapter 24, verses 44 through 53. Jesus said, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then Jesus opened their minds to understand the scriptures. "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witness of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my heavenly parent promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with the power from on high." Then Jesus led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, Jesus blessed them. While he was blessing them, Jesus withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped God and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continually in the temple blessing God. Here is the reading.
Please be seated. Have you ever heard the expression, "That's so fire"? It's the current of Gen Z slang for off the charts awesome. When something happens that is dynamic, amazing, or as we old farts might say, really, really cool, it's now so fire. Speaking of fire, apparently no one really knows why the Cathedral of Notre Dame in Paris caught fire. But Quasimodo has a I tried paying for my pizza by singing, "Bring a fire," but apparently they didn't accept cash. Well, my jokes may not be so fire, but God is. Let us pray. O Lord my God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Jesus promises us that God is with us as a fire life. Fire, for today's purposes, F-I-R-E, fully intimate relational exception. Jesus' best promise to us is the kind of life that Jesus knows will give us our best sense of identity, connection, purpose, mission, and joy. The life that is in sync with God. A life that is fully intimate, relational, and exceptional. A life that we can say is so fire. Can you you say that about your life. I hope you can say that about your life. I want to encourage you to say that about your life, because your relationship with God is so fire. So first, fully intimate. We all need connection. Fully intimate means that we are immersed entirely in the love of God. And that's what entering into the life of God means. It's a kind of spiritual life where we're able to exude joy and peace, wisdom and connection, even in the hard times. And it happens right here, in the here and now, no matter what those circumstances. Full intimacy is purposely engaging with something that fires us up, makes us feel that life is indeed so fire. What gets you connected? What matters most in your life? Makes you excited. One of mine is nature. I can get a natural high out of walking in the woods or a meadow or along the river. It just makes my spirit soar. And everybody has different ways of connecting. For some it is nature, for some it's music, for it's a lot of different things. Maybe it's baking for you. But find what gets you that natural high, that connection with God's Spirit that allows you to live your fire life. What touches your soul? Find it, connect, and you'll understand being fully intimate with God. Second, relational. One of the things that Jesus promises us is eternal life. But it's a lot more than just heaven, this eternal life. Scholars tell us that the word eternal life that's used in the scriptures in the Greek is zoe aionis. And the phrase is suggestive of a kind of life that happens in the fullness of time. It refers not to a duration of life or a future destination in life, but to a quality of life based in the knowledge of God. So our eternal life doesn't start when we die. Our eternal life starts now. When we talk about the way of Jesus, eternal life is not something that we look for in the hereafter, but something that we can have right now, a fully intimate personal relationship with God, in which we come to know God spiritually, emotionally, deeply, truly. In other words, our eternal life starts when we have this connectional relationship with God. And it's always a mystery, because God is a mystery. If we understood God completely and fully, we wouldn't need God, we would be God. We live in a society that wants answers, pat answers. Well, I have some bad news for you. If you're looking for pat answers, you're not going to find them in life. They don't exist. You can fool yourself for a little bit and decide that everything's this, 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 but that's not life. That's your imagination. But when we bond with God in a way that makes us one with God, Jesus was talking about in the scripture today, time disappears. Life may not ever make sense entirely. It won't. But you'll know that you're covered, that God's got your back, and the Holy Spirit is with you. Jesus explains to his disciples that Jesus himself has had this relationship with God as Jesus completed his mission on earth, and that Jesus was now offering the same kind of relationship to his disciples and thus to us, so that we too can know God and Jesus in the person of the Holy Spirit personally and intimately, and can therefore do amazing things and live fire lives. The Holy Spirit is tasked with a mission to unify the disciples of God, the ones back then, the ones today, to unify us in a way that enables us to harness that power of healing and change that makes us able to have an impact in the world in which we live in right now. I can't imagine living my life without the many angels with skin on them that I do. Aren't they precious? Always wonderfully surprising and appearing when we need them. We just have to look. This eternal life condition allows us to experience a special relationship with God, and all who belong, who believe, are gifted with this eternal life. The ability to forge a life with God, in which Jesus resides in us and we in Jesus now and in the future. It's a life that will never be destroyed, never ends. And that fire, fully intimate, relational, exceptional relationship with God, was designed by God to fulfill us in a way that nothing else can. You can have all the wealth in the world. If you don't have that fire, you're going to find it meaningless, as most millionaires and billionaires find. You can have the best job in the world, but if you don't have that fire, that relationship with God, you're going to find it meaningless. It's going to disappoint you. People will disappoint you. But when you have that fire relationship with God, ain't nothing can keep us down low. In this connection, we discover our true identity, our purpose, and we're able to be fully ourselves. I think one of the things that Jesus meant when he came to proclaim liberty and release to the captives and those who are oppressed is to liberate us from our minds, to liberate us from our worry about what's somebody going to think. Because we spend a lot of time imprisoned right here, instead of just being and fully embracing our life with God, we worry about what somebody else is going to think or say or do, or how we don't measure up to whatever expectation was set up for us by somebody that we've decided we had to adopt. Hooey. We don't have to live like that. We can live a fire life. When we feel God's call upon our lives, we come to know the joy and the peace and the contentment that only those living in sync with God have discovered. We feel ourselves connected to ourselves, to God, and to the world around us in new and amazing ways. How many times were you amazed this week? The answer to that question should be every single day. Every single day finds something that amazes you. I can be amazed by a clover. I can be amazed by the warmth of the sunlight on my face. I'm always amazed anytime I go outside and my face doesn't hurt. Because it's not winter. When our lives are lived relationally oriented instead of thing-oriented, then our lives are filled with meaningful relationships. And we become more open to new ways of being, new ways of doing. Ways that are so fire! Third, exceptional. Anyone who has been in any kind of a long-term relationship of any kind understands that to know things about a person is not the same as knowing a person. I can know a lot about whoever, but that doesn't mean that I really know them. That personal, intimate knowledge of someone, their nature and being, their energy and personality, their heart and soul, it's a different kind of a knowing. It's a connective knowing. And it's not different from our knowing God. It is the same, in fact. It is the same love. It is the same relational dynamic. A connective knowing, a deep, resonant knowing that allows us to bond with someone heart to heart, soul to soul. Sometimes it happens in an instant. Sometimes it happens over a period of time with human beings. But we all need that connection. We all need that soul power. And that's what Jesus wants for us. Wants us to connect with God through the power of the Holy Spirit and with all of our loved ones. Jesus says that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And the way of Jesus is our relational connection with Jesus. Because Jesus is the truth. The relational connection with Jesus through the Holy Spirit allows us to live our own truth as well as God's truth. Because we're here for a reason. We're not just replaceable. Our society wants us to believe that human beings are commodities. We're more than commodities. We are irreplaceable. We are unique and fantastic. And when we come together, where two or more are gathered, amazing fire things happen. God is the vehicle through which we have that exceptional, connectional relationship. Not just with God, but with others around us. And if we're in tune with God, it's going to be in tune with the world around us too. So that we aren't taking more than we need from Mother Earth. And we're honoring where we're receiving those resources. So Jesus, in our scriptures today, was no longer physically with the disciples. Jesus ascended into heaven. But the connection that Jesus made with God and with those disciples did not end. And it grew. And it is still growing today. The Holy Spirit fires us up and gives us life for the journey. Always. This sense of life that gives us energy and purpose and drive and passion in what we do. If you look up the definition of life, you'll find that it's the capacity for growth, reproduction, activity, and continual change preceding death. We take life for granted. Life is, oh, when you're living, that's life. Think about that, growth. The first word in that is growth. Are we growing? Are we changing, adapting? Because that's life, that's living. Continual change. The word comes from the Indo-Germanic root leap, right? To stick to or adhere. Life is sticky. Life is sticky. And that can be messy, but it can also be really good. And I'm kind of stuck on you guys. I really am. Because you're awesome. You're so fire. And I brag about you every chance I get. Life is connection. Through relationship, through connection, we find that we have the capacity to grow, to reproduce good things, to continue to change, as long as life persists. In the book of Genesis, we see that God created everything that we know as life to be in relationship. There's nothing that God created that was not meant to be in relationship to. Think about it. We live in a grand ecosystem of interconnections and relationships, and even the smallest particles are all interconnected. The more we find out about science, the more wondrous, awesome, amazing, mysterious life becomes. Because everything in existence exists interdependently. Everything. The rocks, the trees, everything. Not independently. So why is it that we as human beings think that it's our God-given right to be independent? Why do we value independence so much higher than interdependence? I say it's because we're not in sync with God. We're not aligning our priorities right, because our interdependence should matter a hell of a lot more than our independence. And Lord knows, we're an independent bunch. When we acknowledge our exceptional interdependence, when we recognize our intimate connection with God, with others, and ourselves, we gain a kind of stability and a peace that can be described as soul fire. The gospel writer of John often writes philosophically and kind of ethereally, and sometimes he can lose us in lofty descriptions and theology. But Jesus' message in today's reading is clear. Jesus is passing on Jesus' own status, Jesus' knowledge, and Jesus' blessing to those that Jesus is leaving behind. Jesus' ability to live a fire life is also our ability to live a fire life. We have the opportunity, as Jesus did, to enter into this incredible relationship with God and with our world. And we discover in our loving that we have a special purpose in the world that only we can fulfill. Because I guarantee you, there is someone in your world that needs your love. Not my love, not Jeff's love, your love. There is at least one person, and probably a lot of people, who need your love in all different sorts of ways. Nice thing is, we're not in this alone. We are connected, and we can do a lot together. Our love is multiplied when we come together, like for the food pantry, for example. That special relationship with God is not reserved for only a few. It's for all who call upon the living God and enter into this fire life. We still have so much to do to continue Jesus' mission of love and hope. So get fired up, people of God. Live the fire life of the Spirit, the gift that you have been given. For God is with us. Amen.
Draw the winding road.
God says, come, eat, sit at table. But before we do that, let's take a moment and allow God to remove anything that keeps us from communion with the holy, from communion with our brothers and sisters, or from communion with creation. Let us pray. Holy One, we honor the long and winding road that has brought us here together, and we thank you for the journey. Show us, God, how to take heart, how to express the fire, the passion that you give us as we live out our days. Holy One, gather us in the Spirit's tether as together we pray in the manner Jesus taught his own disciples to pray. Our Creator,
in heaven and all around us, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen. Hear now the good news. Life is mysteriously wonderful, colorful, exceptional. And so are you. God is a God of love and forgiveness who runs to meet you with open arms. In the name of the Creator, Redeemer, and Holy Spirit, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. So the table's set. We set our grace. And now we remember. We remember how Jesus took the bread, blessed it, broke it, and offered it to his friends, saying, take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. How after supper, Jesus lifted the cup, blessed it, gave thanks, and offered it to his friends, saying, this is my love poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink this, remember me. Holy One, we bring all of who we are to this table to ask your blessings. We ask your blessings on fruit of the field and fruit of the vine and the many ways in which we celebrate and receive them in our diversity or fail to understand them at all. May they be soul food for our spiritual journeys. In the name of Jesus, the joy giver, we pray. Amen. This is an open table. You need not be a member of this church or any church to receive what God offers you here today. Our ushers and helpers would come forward at this time.
Thank you. Thank you.
thank you, God, for making this fire happen in our lives. Thank you for the meal that we've shared together and the meals that are yet to come. May your blessings be upon all of it, God, whether here or shared in the sanctity of our homes. In the name of Jesus, the joy giver, we pray. Amen. Please rise, whether in body or spirit, as you are able for our closing prayer.
Sharing the laughter and the hope, the fears and the tears.
Yay!